Good morning, afternoon, evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm George Moss, host of the program here called What's Going on AllPointsTV.com. And we just love the intro song. So when we start, we have the music still playing.
I must have that repeat. Because you can have stuff play repeated. I think I must have clicked on that when I put it up. So sorry about that.
That's all right, because and Dave Meaton is the one that one of the local persons here, born and raised in Flint, gave us the theme for the program, and I definitely appreciate it. And we just can't stop playing it. Glad you're out there with us today. Hope you stay tuned for the next hour, and we'll be here trying to bring up some topics I hope you're interested in. And feel free to call us at your leisure at 810-250-7365. That's our number here at the studio at allpointstv.com. And we would love to hear from you as to how we're doing here at the studio and all of our programs. And feel free to critique and do what they do for Sean Hannity. You know, Sean Hannity has a new part of his program when they call in and they're pretty much cursing him out. But we have thick skin here too, and so call and let us know how we're doing. And don't think you can hurt our feelings, because we enjoy the feedback and we can always improve on what we're doing here. Stay tuned to all the programs. Every second and fourth Mondays, our program proceeds. The program calls the Tourist Black History Corner. And they come on every second and fourth Mondays. And we are here every Monday without any break in the action, so to speak. We're going to be here. And we're going to be here today from 2 o'clock to 3 o'clock as well. Okay. there are a couple of things that are breaking. I wanted to come to the studio and talk about the book by Murray Rothbard, but I'm going to start off. Rothbard's book is called What Has Government Done to Our Money? And also the book by Thomas DeLorenzo called Organized Crime, The Unvarnished Truth About Government. But I wanted to start off with some breaking news, and that is the news about, it just came out this morning, I think it was, and that's Susan Rice. It seems like she's the one that unmasked the names of those persons that were under surveillance by the Obama administration. And I think now it's pretty much determined that there was some felonious, I think these are felonious, quite frankly. This surveillance of a candidate for president of the United States, this is very serious business. You know, I'm kind of thinking that we've got to make a statement here, because if you can put surveillance on candidates running for the highest office in the country, I mean, what does that mean? What kind of democracy can you have when you have the government that is listening in on the conversation of an adversarial candidate running in another party, and they're using the power of government to listen in on the conversation and then undermine, based upon the listening in on the conversation, undermine the candidacy of the opponent in another party? That sounds a lot like one party rule, you know, where you in fact are in power and you smash the parties that's trying to challenge the parties in power, and you're going to make sure they don't get any footing to in fact change the party that's in power, and therefore you have what do you have in that case? So you have a dictatorship.
The thing is that I don't know if you've been keeping track of it, you probably have because you're an academic too, but it was like it was some university, a college professor and a couple of her students, a former student and a current one, had an exchange on Facebook, and she's actually called up their place of employment, try to get them fired over their political views. And this is a woman, I have never seen it to this level.
I've never seen
this much rage about each other. And the thing is, the left does not explain anything. They just go up, they just go on emotion, and they don't try to talk to you about anything. As soon as you have any question or any problem with what they're saying, and you bring it up, it's a litany of name calling. You just get called a string of epithets, and then you're saying, okay, but what's the... And then they like walk off like they're morally superior because they called you a bunch of names.
Mm-hmm.
They're fuming because they're so... I mean, it's like, basically, it's like driven by some kind of emotion rather than actually thinking things through. I mean, there's emotions. You make your personal decisions based on emotions, and probably they're disastrous most of the time.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, on a national level, international level, because we always connect to the international scene, you should be more rational and start looking at things and look at the truth, see what you action you take now, what consequences they may have later. No, it's emotions right now.
Yeah.
And that's like so, and the left is so extreme like that right now.
Yeah, John, I'm wondering how much of the left is just outed at this point. How much of this was behind the scenes and we were not cognizant of it because it did not have to express itself as openly as being expressed right now? You know, I wonder how much of that is what we're seeing.
I saw that 20-some years ago when I was still at U of M. And we'll go in personal detail because the professors may still be there. But it was bizarre world. I mean, it was already getting that bad.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm so glad I'm no longer at the university, either as a student or as an employee, because, oh my God, it's insanity. I mean, I got friends that still work in the academic world and, you know, support staff and stuff, and they're shake their head. They're just buying their time so they can get their pension. Because it's grading on them. I mean, it's causing them a lot of stress. This anger and this hostility towards anybody. And some of these people are on the left, but they think it's gone too far.
When I was at the university, and we would have various seminars, and you'd be in the same room for a lot of the other professors, I was really quite surprised by some of the conversations they would engage in. And I guess I was the odd person out. I was sitting there listening to a lot of the conversations. Well, like in one case, I was listening to them talking about the prohibition of the voting prohibition if you require persons to get driver's license. And I think I was only a black professor at that time in that particular seminar. And here I am, and they're saying, you know, they're trying to protect blacks so that blacks would have the right to vote. And here I'm in there as a black person, and I'm saying, I had to object to the conversation because I thought it was very disingenuous on their part to tell us that, to tell me and to say that blacks of all the groups that are in the country, that they are singularly unable to get the requirements, some kind of photo ID that identifies the voters of these persons who are coming to the polls to register their vote and cast a ballot for the candidate of their choice. They are the single group in the country that could not do that. When I know that you have to have ID to drive, and I don't know how many persons that are 18 and over who are not driving or don't have a license. And so I just took some umbrage with that statement. And I guess they were looking at me and saying, well, it seemed like, and one person actually told me, I won't call his name out, but he told me, well, I would think that you'd be on the side of this because, and he was talking about the fact that I was black, I'd be on the side of it. Well, I don't take positions based upon the color of the book. Based upon the color of the position.
You know what's really weird? The left accuses the right of identity politics, but yet it's them who engage in identity politics.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like, and I never understood the concept of that until just recently. Really dawned on me. It's like, well, it happens with the Zionist. You know, that's fueled largely by a sense of identity and stuff like that, cultural identity or ethnic identity. And they also got this we deserve privilege because this thing was done for so long to us that we now should be exempted from all laws, but everybody else has got to follow them.
Yeah.
I think that's bizarre, too. I mean, they're saying we're equal, but they want to have a grossly misrepresentation by saying, you know, we are allowed to do this because we're... So now, from now on, we got to tilt in this unfavor to everybody else to make it rectify some kind of... cosmically rectify the past. Wrong. I just think that's bizarre.
Yeah, it is bizarre. I have a lot of persons that are mad at me in the town. They're going to continue to be mad too because I'm not changing anything. But they continue to be mad at me because I have, when Obama was president, I think in 2000, I voted for him in 2008 because I wanted to get past some of the discussions we were having in this country. And I thought by electing Barack Obama, we could get past this conversation that slavery is still here and people are being held down because they are out back picking cotton. And I knew that this was not the country of our grandparents, black and white grandparents. And so I wanted to make a have that election in 2008 as a statement to that effect. But little did I know at the time that the conversation would have gotten worse. And under Obama, quite frankly, whatever the racial tensions were in the country prior to him being elected, they got worse during the 8 years he was in office. And so the idea he come in as a healer, and he certainly came in, the campaign he ran was that. And not that I believe everything he was talking about. I mean, the guy was in a church where you had Reverend Wright that was there. He was in there 20 years, and he wasn't wearing earmuffs during that time period. So when this man was up there cursing the country out, Obama, unable to hear it, I guess he was wearing some kind of, his ears were hermetically sealed. He didn't hear him up there cursing the country out. But when I began to listen to this, listen to Obama in 2009, particularly June the 4th, 2009, that's when he went over to Cairo and he was speaking over there at the University of Al-Azhar in Egypt. And I listened to that speech, but then I could not believe what I was hearing, so I asked for the transcript. And when I read the transcript, and then having found that my ears had not deceived me, that I had heard what I heard, although it was hard to believe a person would say these things, a president would say these things outside the country, where he's outside the country criticizing the country, that was unprecedented. And so I was trying to make sure that I wasn't running off with a false notion of what had been said. I want to make sure that I had my ducks all lined up, so to speak. And so I wanted to get a copy of the speech, and I read it. When I read it, it was the same thing that I'd heard. And that's when my eyes began to open up to the fact that we had elected someone who was different than, well, that's what politicians do, but somebody that was 180 degrees away from what he had presented himself to be during the campaign. And where we heard that story before, that's pretty much the story of politicians. But I did not assume at that time that it would be to the extent that I found it in this president, who was almost on the opposite ends of the spectrum of what he had presented to the voters and who he really was behind his masking. And of course, I believe that all politicians are masked, and the longer they're inside of the political process, the more masked they are, because you have to tell more and more lies in order to get elected. So the longer you're there, the more corrupt you are. I understand that goes with the territory. But when I begin to listen to this quacking by this president in June 4th, 2009, that I knew then that we had something else in the White House that went beyond what you would normally expect with politicians. I don't expect any of them to be honest, but this was something different. And what really was, I began to pay attention to, was that this person went outside the country and was criticizing the country that he had just been recently installed as president on the 20th of January. This was just 6 months earlier, and he had just been recently inaugurated as the 44th president of the United States, and he's over in a foreign country criticizing the country off the shores of the country. That you never see that. And when I saw it, I had to do a double take to make sure that I was on, you know, firm grounds to come out with a critique of it. Because when I saw that the speech did say what I heard, I knew then that I had to stand up against it. Because I voted for this man in 2008. I didn't vote for him in 2012. And that's why my friends, my associates, and I fell out. Because I was very vocal about the fact that I was not going to vote for him, and I didn't vote for him.
But you know, I've had people, you know, who watch your show criticize you, both you and I, that we never seem to be satisfied with any of the presidential offerings. I mean, when I was in college, people would ask me, who do I like as president? You know, yeah. And I've been around, I was really cognizant of what was going on and stuff when Richard Nixon was president. I was far too young to vote, but I thought he was, you know, I also had a tendency to like him, and I think he did it. The water, you and I, sub, you know, part ways. We think, I think he ordered the Watergate break-in. But anyway, from all the way down, I think Reagan did commit an act of treason by, you know, continuing an illegal war, funding an illegal war. I think he should have been propelled on, I think he should have been held in, you know, for a trial, for, you know, face trial charges of treason because he violated the Constitution. And that ticks off a lot of the staunch conservatives because they just like his button-down, articulate approach to life. I mean, they love that. They're enamored of that, where I'm a constitutionalist.
Mm-hmm.
And Jimmy Carter, I mean, he doesn't even, you know, to me, he was a nice guy. He should have stayed the governor of Georgia and stayed the hell out of that international politics because, I mean, I don't think he knew what he was doing. He was a peacemaker, but, you know, yeah, where did all his stuff do go to? So I mean, I don't have any of my like. I didn't like Clinton because I think he was like a frat boy in the Oval Office. That's what he acted like to me. I think he was a reprehensible character. Yeah, as governor of Arkansas, I think he was like a lot of the questionable things. I mean, and his wife too. So I mean, I don't have any. I never liked any of them because I think they're dirtbags.
Yeah, John, I think they're surprised by my political outlook, and a lot of my friends, associates have gotten mad at me, which that doesn't bother me. I don't, you know, I could care less. The only friend I have is the truth. And anyone that does not want to friend me on Facebook in my associate groups and all of that, that's fine with me. I'm not bothered by it. But when I saw what I saw, and I was assured of the fact of what this man had done, I knew then I couldn't support him. And so in 2012, I was very vocal, both on the internet and taking a lot of hits because of that, because Mr. Moss, you taught this and you you taught that. Yeah, I taught it, but I didn't teach anybody to be making choices based upon the color of somebody's skin. And when I saw this man, I consider Obama to be an enemy combatant. You know, this man to me was a hidden enemy combatant in the White House. And when I began to discover that to be true, because I saw this man taking one position after another against the country. And that's not what Dr. King was talking about on August 28th, 1963, when King said that he had a dream that was deeply, he said that the dream is deeply rooted in the American dream. King wasn't talking about something that was over here that was going to be in contradiction to the ideals of the country.
But now for people who might be viewers of, you know, coming in, you know, don't know your story, weren't you actually there when he made that original speech?
Yeah, I was there. John, a whole lot. We were, you know, college students were very active at that time. You know, we were kind of like, you know, and that's kind of like a different thing we have right now, where the college students are kind of in a mindset that if they have a viewpoint that they disagree with, they don't want to hear it. We wanted to embrace the metrics, you know, the country's ideals. And if we were so grounded in what we believed in as far as the ideals, perfecting the American ideal, that if someone had an opposite viewpoint, we weren't trying to shut that, I wasn't trying to shut it down. And I guess because I went to a very private school, my undergrad was at a private school, a Presbyterian school. And so we were kind of like incubated maybe a little bit from the larger, like Berkeley and these other schools, but we were very, I didn't feel we were not open to ideals different from my own. But I know that when King called for the March on Washington, you know, I'm from Birmingham, so quite frankly, that was my hometown. And I do teach that is out of Birmingham, that the energy for the March on Washington was in fact exercised, because without Birmingham, I don't think the March on Washington would have worked. Not this March on Washington, the one that was held on May 17th, 1957, the third anniversary of Brown versus Board. Nobody even remembers that march. There were 25,000 folks at that march that King had in 57. Nobody's heard about it because it didn't resonate the same way. But after Birmingham, when Boyd Carter was the police commissioner in Birmingham, and they were getting ready to tried to get the right to vote and all these things in the South. People were bothered by these this behavior of people like Bull Connor putting dogs on children and things like that. And when King was going to, when they called another march on Washington, 6 years after the one they had in 57, then that was something that energized us. We were bothered by those images on the screen. And really, a lot of college students were the ones that were doing the sit-ins and demonstrations, the freedom rides. These were college students doing that. People sitting at lunch counters like they did in Greensboro, North Carolina. The college students were activated. So when King said, when it really wasn't King, it was Asa Villa Randolph, who had been trying to get a march in Washington since 1941 under Roosevelt. And then Roosevelt bought him off by promising some things in terms of integrating the armed forces. And then Asa Villa Randolph then backed down from having a march in Washington in 1941. But 22 years later, the idea comes up again because of Birmingham. And then out of Birmingham, the march in Washington finally did come off 22 years after Randolph had, you know, thought of the idea. Let's have a massive, you know, demonstration. Now, King had 25,000 in 1957, but given the airing on television of those children being washed down the street and dogs being put on these children in high school, that bothered this nation. See, my view of America is that America is a very moral nation. The American people are. Now, I'm not talking about the politicians. That's a whole different subject. I'm talking about the American people. When they see something that they know is fundamentally immoral, I'll tell you this nation will rise up against it. That's been the history of this nation. And they can say what they want to. I'm going to be doing a couple of series because a lot of people are challenging what I write on Facebook. But one guy was saying yesterday that he can't hardly wait until I write this one series he's going to be writing because he doesn't like me saying it. But I'm writing one on Ted Cruz. I like Ted Cruz, respect him, but Ted Cruz not able to run for president, and because some people like him, they want to challenge what I'm saying and say something else. Well, I'll tell you this. I like Ted Cruz, but that does not change the fact. And I understand the baggage the country has in its past, but it does not change the fact that the American people are basically a very moral people. And when they see something that goes down that they don't like and they know is immoral, they will rise up against it. And sometimes they do it to a fault. And they're going to really be mad at me because I wrote an article just the other day about this same-sex marriage thing. Everybody's talking about you're in order for you to not be discriminatory against persons that fall in love with their partner, that somehow you have to have marriage as a way of qualifying it so you can respect it. You can, in other words, you can only tolerate it if you normalize it. And I can respect it without normalizing it. I'm not going to normalize two men marrying and two women marrying. And that gets a lot of people hollering at me and calling me a homophobe and all that kind of. I'm not a homophobe. They're the homophobe because they have to normalize that in order to accept it. I accept the person has the right to fall in love with who they want to. But be that as it may, I'm going to defend that woman down there in Kentucky that did not want to, because her religion did not allow her to issue that license. I don't care what they said. They could have found somebody else to do it. They could have brought somebody else in there and not violated her religion. I bet you we're not going to make a Muslim sell pork. Let me see you pass a law saying that. You're not fooling me with that nonsense. But people were bothered by that. So I went to Washington, and I was there as one of 250,000 persons that were there. And I also went back to Washington 2000, and I went to Glenn Beck called his march. Was that 2010? Was it somewhere around there? I was there for that one as well. And I'll tell you that, Glenn Beck had more people there than King did. And I didn't do a count of it, but I can tell you this. I know what the numbers were when they had 250,000 there. I saw Glenn Beck's rally, and they claim everything they want to. I saw those numbers. Those numbers, that place, and now they're trying to say that Donald Trump didn't have the numbers that Obama had in 2009. And I saw that inauguration. And the one that Donald Trump had, that went on until next Tuesday. They can claim what they want to. I saw, when you're there, you can tell what the numbers are. When they said 250,000, okay, I know what 250,000 look like. But what I saw when I went there with the Beck rally, and they had in there Martin Luther King's niece, I have a lot of respect for her. You know, this woman is not playing. This is a very serious woman. A.D. King, you know, Dr. King had a brother named A.D. King, named after his grandfather on his mother's side, Alberta King, whose father was A.D. Williams. And his name was named after A.D. So A.D. King, brother A.D. Williams, the grandfather. So A.D. was the brother of Martin Luther King, and his daughter was there, one of the speakers at that Glenn Beck rally. They were trying to say he didn't have these numbers, only nobody showed up and didn't have anybody. What I saw was a larger group than were there on the 28th of August of 1963. And what I was really impressed about is that they had a large crowd there. I think, I don't want to guess at it, but I know it's more than 250,000. And what I was really impressed with is when they left those grounds, there was not so much as a gum wrapper that was on the grounds. They picked up everything. There was no litter. They had a lot of respect for the nation's capital. And then when they came behind them with the left now meeting in Washington, it was a whole different thing in that situation. But to make a long story short, and I always make these stories longer than they should be, is that, you go and see the morality of the nation. Now, I testify to the fact that America is a very moral nation. Now, when I talk about the politicians, that's something different. I don't respect these politicians. And anybody that's reading my post on Facebook, if you wait for me to write something that's complimentary to any of the politicians, you'd be waiting until haters freezes over. I don't respect these politicians. When they start talking, I stop listening. I don't believe anything they say. And I certainly don't believe what they're saying about Donald Trump. And I was saying at the beginning of the program that Susan Rice, I think that the news now, I think she's been outed. That Susan Rice, you know, the one that was going on those programs on five television programs and lying on that Sunday when they sent her out there to tell the American people something that was not true. Well, when the report today, this morning, the breaking story is that Susan Rice is the one who, after the surveillance of Donald Trump, which starts in 2015, and didn't stop, if they talk about it, it was because of the fear or concern of the Russian influence in the 2016 election, then what explains why, when the election was over on November the 8th, 2016, what explains the fact they continued to, in fact, monitor Donald Trump's transition team? I mean, after the mandate is over, because we got a president-elect right now, and the only thing we're waiting for now is inauguration. So the baton has now been passed to the next president, who is just waiting for the inauguration to be installed in the presidency. So that administration is going down. This one's coming into his own, having his own time. What we had at that point was another administration coming into being, and this one's going out of existence. So what then would explain the continuation of looking into this, if it was about the election, after the election was over, and this president continued to monitor and surveil this the president-elect after the election was over, and did that even throughout November, the rest of November, did it throughout December, and continued to, in fact, undermine the transition of this administration into January. And I think it was, what, 7 days before the president would have his inauguration, the 20th of January. I think on the 13th of January, this president took what they had surveilled and passed it through not just the agencies that were in place, but put it in the hands of 16 different federal agencies. And I think that the reason for that is very clear. Because if you put it in all those different agencies and somebody begins to leak it and unmask the persons that were on those, that's on those tapes, you unmask those persons, it's harder for you to trace it. If you have two agencies that have, that's privy to it, the FBI and the NSA, and that'll be Comey and that'll be Mike Rogers, then you can kind of narrow it down. But how do you narrow it down when you have a wider array of intel groups through which this information has been disseminated? And that's what Obama did. And when they said Susan Rice this morning was the one that did the unmasking of these names, one of whom was General Flynn, then I know then if it goes as high as Susan Rice, then that involves Barack Obama. That is no question about that. In fact, you probably are aware that when Obama, and there were a lot of people didn't think Obama was going to leave office. I kept saying he is going to leave. He's not that brazen. But that does not mean he's going to capitulate and give in to the things that are going to happen once Donald Trump comes in, because Donald Trump is going to undo almost everything that Obama put in place, particularly these restrictions on the economy. You know, these regulations. These people overregulated the economy because they want power, and they overregulate to keep the business world from being influential, and by repressing the business community, they can then create more need, and the need is being met by government, therefore it creates a need for the politicians, who are basically obsolete, quite frankly. There's no need for these politicians, and basically they're obsolete. And they were intended to be obsolete by the framers. You can go read the Constitution and see it. But they make themselves necessary by creating a need for their intrusion. And what Trump is trying to do is take these regs, these regulations, and reduce these regulations, and get the stranglehold off of business in the country, and allow the businesses to expand so that the people can become more independent. And if they become more independent, that lessens the power of government, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And that's where the fallout is with Donald Trump. But Susan Rice's name is very important, because it was clear that when Obama stepped down from the presidency, right down the street from the White House in the area of the power center, Barack Obama is still there. The excuse being that his daughter has not finished school yet, and so therefore he's there until his daughter finishes high school, the younger daughter finishing high school, and that's why he's still in Washington. But what was really interesting was that Susan Rice was going to move into the house that they're renting in Washington, and she's going to be moving in, and they were going to form what some were saying was a deep state government, an alternative government, one that is operating on its own authority without recognizing the authority that's been installed and that's been instituted in the election of Donald Trump, because the voters that went there supposedly were influenced by Russia, so therefore that is not a valid election. And you even hear him saying that now. You have Perez up there, Sunday, was up there saying, very emotional, that Donald Trump is not the president of the United States, that he wasn't elected. And this man is totally This man doesn't even understand the American system. And that's why you have to do be out there making having people unfriend you, because you got to point out you cannot let this stuff stand, this dangerous rhetoric stand, without correcting what they're saying here. Donald Trump was elected. The popular vote doesn't elect the president. The electoral vote elects the president in this country. And it's never been any different in this election than it's been in all the previous elections. We've had elections in the past where popular vote, the first time the popular vote did not, where the popular vote differed from the electoral vote was in 1824, when Andrew Jackson won a majority of the popular vote but didn't become president because he didn't have a majority of the electoral votes. Neither one of the kings had a majority electoral vote. And therefore, it was thrown in the House of Representatives, which is a backup plan in the Constitution. If no candidate has a majority of the electoral votes because of a multiple number of candidates running, then the way it works in the Constitution is then it's thrown in the House of Representatives, that is the people's body, and their representatives, therefore, decide, because they are the representatives of the people, they then decide who the president would be, and that decision was made by the House. And so rather than Andrew Jackson, who had most of the popular votes, becoming president, John Quincy Adams, the son of John Adams, became the sixth president. John Quincy Adams became the sixth president, and his father, of course, who had been the second president of the United States. That was not surprising, because the Electoral College elects the president of the United States. They didn't have a riot over it. And no one said that John Quincy Adams wasn't a legitimate president because he didn't get the popular vote. So when Perez up there talking, basically out of his mind, then he doesn't know American history. And here's a man that is the new chair of the DNC, and this man doesn't even know the Constitution of the country. I mean, this is very dangerous what is going on. And they have this noise out here saying that the Russians undermine the election that we had in November, but that's not really what was undermining the election in this country. What's undermining this election in this country are the people in the Democratic Party and those on the left that refuse to take the mandate of the American people that voted in multiple majorities in this country to elect Donald Trump as president of the United States. Now, I know they keep talking about this overriding thing of the majority of the voters in this country. And wait until I get to this in my Facebook post, because that's gonna be a part of what I'll be posting on Facebook as I begin to talk about Joseph Story and Daniel Webster, who I think in the 1830s laid the intellectual foundations for the so-called Civil War. Because Joseph Story and Daniel Webster in the 1830s were making this argument that the framers voted as a total body of the American people for the ratification of the Constitution of the United States, rather than voting as a state, the states voting for the Constitution. In other words, majorities in each of the states separately endorsing the Constitution of the United States. Now, that's what happened. What Story and Webster were claiming was that this was a majority of the people in total, and therefore it was this totality, not the states. And the danger of that was, if the totality was what endorsed the Constitution, then the states had lost their sovereignty as independent republics. And I'll be writing about that, because I think the story, I don't have to think about it, I know for a fact that Joseph Story and Daniel Webster were the intellectual engines that gave credence to this idea that states could not secede from the Union, which was the ultimate thing that they held in reserve. If government got out of control, they could in fact withdraw their support of the government. That's the ultimate ace card that they, the Trump card that they had to play against the encroachment of the government getting too large and too intrusive in the affairs of the states, which was not intended by the framers. Yeah. And I have to write about that. I'm going to be writing about that real soon to clean that up.
You know, that reminds me of one conservative commentator, and I wish for the life of me I can remember the guy's name. He said it's like a sobering thought when you look at the Bible. It says, you know, the book of Judges is followed so closely by the book of Kings. What it means is basically the form of governance they had underneath Judges compared to what they had a king. And he actually, Samuel the prophet in the Bible said, don't have a king. And he took give all the reasons why. Yet, we founded a republic. We had a republic founder where we had a great deal of latitude, a great deal of flexibility and freedom and liberty potential. And it just like tripped away, and it was like painless. I mean, there's always justifications for it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what the thing is. I mean, that's what they did with it. I mean, and now the federal government's got even more of a clause into the, you know, the states, because they take from us the funding, then they give it back to us with an eyedropper and saying, oh, here's all the impositions and all the all the things, conditions you're going to have mm-hmm. before we give it back to you.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, and we allow that. I mean, and without blinking, our leadership is based, oh, yeah, they made the deal with the devil because they said it was basically just for payola. I promise these people, this is the way I can get it to them.
Yeah.
And that's what it is. We just allowed it to be, we handed over our liberty for a bowl of lentils, basically. That's what we did.
The framers would be very surprised if they came here and saw what the federal government has become and what the states have become, because the states were considered to be the creators of the federal government. If you say, for example, that in the 10th Amendment, for example, where it says all of the powers that are not specifically given expressly to the federal government, if it is not delegated, then those rights then remain with the states and to the people therein. The question is, if you say, for example, that the federal government is a government whose powers are delegated, the question then becomes, who's delegating those powers? Certainly you're not saying that the federal government is going to delegate its own powers and then restrict itself. We don't see any evidence of it now in terms of the government. The federal government wants to claim all the powers. But who's delegating these powers? And who is making sure that it is in fact itemized? You know, look, you go read Article 1, Section 8, and you see the itemization of the rights, of the powers rather, given to the federal government. And it says that therefore, that is not enumerated in Article 1, Section 8, therefore those powers not so enumerated, not so delegated, will in fact be retained within the states. So the states are speaking. And the states are saying that we are going to give this much authority to the federal government. And beyond that, then there's this barrier between those powers and the states, behind which are the people. And the federal government cannot jump over that in terms of being intrusive over that barrier. Not even to the point of taxing the people. The states could tax directly the people, but the federal government cannot do so. And there's even an argument. I'll be writing this. I'm going to be doing that article very, very soon. It's got to have to be a five-part. I was going to make it a three-part series, but it's got to be a five-part series now that I'm thinking more about it as I'm thinking about how I'm going to put it together. But it's got to be a five-part series because there's so many different components of it. And one component of it I'm going to be writing about is why the framers did not have the Bill of Rights beholden to the states. The Bill of Rights didn't apply to the states. These are prohibitions put specifically upon the federal government. Now, there are some people at the convention that are arguing that it should be applicable to the states as well, but that was argued down.
Now, according to what my understanding, now correct me if I'm wrong, you brought this up in a way, state laws cannot be like in violation of U.S. Constitution. Is that correct, though?
Yeah, because you have the in Article 6, you have the supremacy clause in Article 6, where when you have the laws of the land, when the federal government has laws, if those laws are constitutionally grounded, then of course the federal law, which is since you have to have the laws apply to all the states that are underneath the federal government, then the federal law must trump it. You can't have 13 different, you can't have chaos here, where each state decides itself what laws it's going to follow and what laws it's not going to follow, as long as the laws are constitutional. But you have to understand something here. The states retain within themselves the right to nullify laws that were unconstitutional. And that's not a Southern based idea. That's a national idea. The first one that actually that brought that up, as a matter of fact, was not a Southern state, it was Massachusetts. And they were going to raise the issue around the idea of trade. You can go read Alexis Tocqueville. Read his works. And you can see that by them coming together and having different cultural interests between the North and the South. There was a new numerical problem also. There were eight states that were in the East. You say North now, but really were Eastern states. And you had five that were Southern states. And there was a numerical disadvantage that the South had. And also there were cultural differences, but basically economic differences as well. And there was a lot of reticence about coming together to form the Union, because there were these economic, and cultural differences. And the question was, would it work? And it's a lot of things you can say about that. I have to write about it, because it just so much you can't cover in 1 hour. There's too much to it. But the federal law trumps state law, but it must be within the context of the Constitution. Why would that be the case? Because the Constitution is the creation of the states. The states have agreed to it. So if you set some law on the federal level that's consistent with the law in the Constitution, how do the states object to what they've already agreed to at the foundation moments of the country? But you have to understand the other part of it. If a law is put in place that goes outside of the agreement, then the states had retained within themselves the power to nullify those laws. That's why you have this idea of the nullification and the interposition of the states in between what the federal government does and the Constitution. They put themselves in between the federal government and the people by putting the Constitution in front of them and saying this cannot be done because of the restraints placed upon the federal government by the Constitution of the United States. So the restriction would have to be the federal government must in fact have its laws consistent with the Constitution of the United States. You can't have this nonsense you have going on right now with these federal judges, these politicians in black robes. That's what these federal judges are today. They are politicians in black robes. And before I came to the studio, they had this thing that's going to be, they're going to go to the nuclear option, because they're not going to give Gorsuch. They're going to filibuster Gorsuch. And they're going to filibuster Gorsuch because Gorsuch will follow the Constitution, and they don't want that. You heard Feinstein say that she believes that the Constitution is a living document. These people in the federal government want a living Constitution. Why? Because they don't want the restraints. We don't have a living Constitution. We have a Constitution that can be amended to fit the situations that were not the framers were not conscious of at the time of the ratification of the Constitution. You can therefore ratify other amendments through the Article 5 of the Constitution. But it says living document where you can say, okay, it meant this language at that time period. Now we're going to apply it to the circumstance that came up since these conditions are new, but you're not going to change the language. That's what Feinstein is saying. That's what the Constitution stands for. And that's not true. You can't legislate. You're not supposed to legislate from the bench. You're supposed to go by what the Constitution says. If they don't do that, we got a problem. And Gorsuch is a kind of constitutionalist that would abide by the Constitution. That's why they want to filibuster is getting on the bench. But the Constitution is written, and it means what it says. If they start going outside of it, then the states have the right to intervene and interpose themselves in between the courts and the Constitution, so that what they're saying can be nullified. And you can go and see before the Civil War, that was the way it worked. You go look at Andrew Jackson and his vice president John C. Calhoun. Look at that conflict they had. Calhoun was defending the Southern interests, and Jackson was doing something quite different away from that, because he was operating upon the interests of the northern industrialists, and you know the northern bankers, well, not the bankers so much, it was the northern mercantilists and in that group. And the interest of the South was being suborned, and they had a conflict right inside of Jackson's administration. And when they did a toast, and Jackson was saying to the Union, and Calhoun lifted his glass and said something very different, and was talking in the tone of secession to hold out there that if these things continue, then that would be an option, the nuclear option, in terms of the South. Because that's the way it was supposed. I'll tell you another thing that's been missed. You go back and read history, and then this time go and read it through another lens. You'll notice that in the first president that the country had, George Washington was from the state of Virginia. Virginia was a southern state. Now John Adams was from Massachusetts, and Massachusetts is a northern state. And you'll see that all the way from 1788 in the first election in this country, with George Washington taking office on March the 4th, 1789. But he was from the South, but the vice president was from the North. And you see that happening in every election. Washington and Adams twice, and then when Adams came in as the president, Massachusetts, then his vice president was Thomas Jefferson. So it was switched. In fact, the first six presidents were either from Massachusetts or from Virginia. They went back and forth. But when there was a president from Virginia, then the vice president was from Massachusetts or in other words, it went back and forth from South. When the president was from the South, then the vice president was from the North. When the president was from the North, then the vice president was from the South. Go and look at that up until 1860. You see, this thing is a little bit bigger than what they say. They say that this is about slavery. I don't think that you can contend that if you know that's part of the story, a very, very small part of the story. I think that the first shot fired in what they call the Civil War, they want to claim that the first shot was fired at Fort Sumter. That's not true. The first shot fired in the Civil War, there were a lot of shots fired, but the one was fired in the immediate time period of what they call the Civil War was when Abraham Lincoln ran as a president from Illinois, and his vice president, you know, don't forget Illinois is a northern state, and his vice president was from Maine, Hannibal Hamlin. That means that you had a president from the North and you're the vice president from the North. And I think that's provocative. I don't even, as I said earlier, I don't even respect these politicians. I think Lincoln was as a former Whig, this man was provoking the South. And he provoked it again in Fort Sumter by not vacating Fort Sumter once the secession taking place. Because once the secession took place, you got two nations now. And that fort is on foreign soil. And when he began to put the rations back in that fort and replenish that fort, then that was a provocative, that was an act of war. And there were two provocations, one in the election and one in not vacating a fort that was now in foreign soil, where South Carolina was willing to pay for the federal building of the fort, but now the fort is no longer in Union territory, it's now in Southern territory. It's now in the Confederacy of the United States. And I want you to look at the word Confederate, the Confederacy, the Confederation, the Confederation of the Southern States. 11 states eventually. And they were in a confederation. That's what was intended. They were going, what they were doing was going back to the original idea of the framers. And Lincoln was going in another direction, and that's what this war is about. I know everybody thinks it's about slavery, because that's what's taught in school. But I'm gonna clean it up when I get around to it, and I gotta do a couple more posts before I get to that. When I get to that, I'm gonna clean it up where we can see what this war was really about. Because the overriding issue behind this war was federal encroachment upon states' rights. That was what was intended by the framers. The states would, in fact, maintain their prerogative as sovereign republics. We were a federal republic of Republican states. And you go read that in Article 1, Section 4 of the Constitution. The federal government will ensure, will guarantee, it says, that every state will have a Republican form of government. It's guaranteed. Because the sovereignty of the states was not, in fact, entered into, given over to the federal government once they, in fact, form a confederation of the states. In fact, they really were talking about having the preamble say, "We the states of the United States." But if they said, "We the states of the United States," they wanted to make it specific to the people of the states. So it was assumed that everyone understood that we the people of the states of the United States. And that's why they said, "We the people of the United States." But what they meant by that was, "We the people of the states." They wanted to make sure the people were represented. "We the people of the states of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union, establish justice, ensure domestic tranquility, provide for the common defense, promote the general welfare, and secure the liberties of to ourselves and our posterity, do ordain and establish the Constitution of the United States of America." And they were very aware in that convention, where they had met from June 25th, 1787 to September 17th, 1787, they were laying the foundations for thinking very carefully about how to put this together, because they wanted this to last. They had understood republics had gone on before and they went out of business. They wanted to make sure this one was there in perpetuity. And they had figured out all the little angles of things could happen so they could put in place guarantees, with the states maintaining their independence within the federal structure, but still in there as independent states, but as part of a polity. So to the question of whether or not does the law, federal law, take precedent over the state law? Yes, it does, as long as it's within the purview of what's allowed to the federal government under the Constitution. If not, then states can nullify it, because they are the creators of federal government and only gave them this much power to do these things within the Constitution of the state ratified. Anything beyond that, they cannot do it. 3/4 of what the federal government is doing, quite frankly, is unconstitutional. And I think the framers, when they came back here, will be aghast at what has happened in the aftermath of the, I think 1913 was a pivotal point in terms of having gone way beyond what was intended by the framers. And it starts with Lincoln, and to a large extent, Lincoln was part of it. And then in 1913, with this changing of the taxation, you have with the 16th Amendment, and then the election of the senators by the popular vote, that was a mammoth shift in the way things were supposed to happen, because the senators were elected by the states. And when they changed that, that's also became a phenomenon that was very, very problematical as well. Okay, well, what I wanted to come here and say basically was that watch what's going on with the shadow government that's being put in place in Washington, because the framers had intended for the verdict to come out of the mandate of the states. And we had that. In other words, the system worked exactly as it's supposed to on November the 8th, and it was not intended to have a shadow government that would subsume the authority that's bequeathed to the federal government by the states electing the President of the United States, as happened in this election last year. Okay, want to watch that? Don't take your eyes off of what's happening right now. Donald Trump is our president of the United States of America. We don't have but one president now, and we don't have Obama and Susan Rice and these others that can take the authority away from what happened as the American people went to the polls and mandated the 45th president of the United States. Okay, want you to follow your dream as always, because if you don't follow your dream, you'll never know what's on the other side of the rainbow.